Okay, so for day three of the class, we're going to focus on YouTube. We've talked about a variety of social networks before, back in part one, and now in part two. And we will finish the course by talking about YouTube, which is one of the biggest social networks slash search engines. You might not really think of it as those things. You might think of it, well, that's the place where I can go look up funny videos. Yes, that's true, but YouTube nowadays is becoming a big player in the world of social networks. Because the things that defined a social network that we looked at before, content, likes, replies, shares, all of that, that also happens on YouTube. You can get likes, you can get comments and shares and all of that on YouTube just like every other network. The big difference between YouTube and the other networks is that the content that you upload to YouTube has to be video content. Whereas the other networks, basically it can be text, links, videos, sounds, etc. Over on YouTube, it has to be video or visual content to really be effective. So we're going to say YouTube, a powerful social network and a powerful search engine. Obviously, the big search engine is Google. Another big search engine is Bing. There's still Yahoo and all of those. But YouTube is also a search engine. You might not have thought about it, but people go to YouTube to search. How do I tie a tie? How can I install WordPress? What is a good, hiking boot? People go to YouTube and ask it a question and search for something just like they would for Google. And for Bing. So if you've got content on YouTube that people are searching for, that could be a way for you to get this exposure, to get the traffic, and it's just another tool, like we've said before, about any social network. It's to build awareness, to build traffic, etc. But it focuses on visuals. So this is a focus on visual content. Whereas the other ones have can do text, can do pictures, can do links. Here's a focus on visuals. And yes, you can kind of halfway do things in that you can have a video that is focused on audio, but it's still a very visual medium. YouTube is what's the term? I just had the term earlier, I forgot. It's YouTube focuses on the pre-made content focus. Whereas there's many new upstarts that are live streaming. We'll say next generation. YouTube focuses on the pre-made content. It started off as a website where you would create a video. You would have it ready, and you would upload it. Makes sense, of course. But in contrast, there's a new generation of networks out there that are live streaming. There are these networks that, I don't have a video ready, but let me turn on my app and start to record something live and streaming. That's the next generation. And some examples of that are Periscope, Meerkat, Facebook, whatever they call theirs, Facebook Live, I think, Twitter Live, which just connects back to Periscope. Twitter owns Periscope. There's BlabIM, there's Twitch.tv, there's one of the grandfathers of it all, Ustream.tv. There's one that I like called LiveCoding.tv. All of these are in the scope of live streaming. All of these are in the new generation about pre-made videos are passé, and we're really going to talk about it in this class. But pre-made videos, perhaps, where you painstakingly designed something and uploaded it, there's a brand new generation of these that are saying, here's the newest thing. Well, even YouTube itself is seeing that, so yes, there is the live streaming aspect of YouTube as well. I can take that over here now, everyone's already signed it. So even YouTube is getting in this live streaming business. We're not going to talk about that very much. That has its own requirements, its own character, its own sort of content. So we're not going to talk about the live streaming stuff, and there's plenty that we could say about it. I believe I mentioned it in this class. What you want to do is you want to go over to socialmediaexaminer.com, one of the best places to keep up to date with all of the social media stuff. So we're going to focus on the pre-made content. We're going to focus on, there's a video, we're going to upload it to YouTube, and then we're going to talk about optimizing it and getting traffic for it and monetization. We can actually make money off of our YouTube channel, our YouTube account. I'll back up about here, YouTube, a focus on monetization. You can't exactly as easily make money off of your Twitter account or your Facebook and that sort of thing, but you can make money off of your YouTube, I believe, a lot easier than the other networks. We'll talk about that, of course. Now, if YouTube focuses on pre-made content, which is what we will focus on, that assumes you have a video. I had said on the previous days of the class, you don't have to have a video. I will provide you one. But if the course were 4 weeks long, we could take some time to spend a day on video creation. We're going to assume we've got a video, but just for some notes and some info here, tools for video creation. Many of these could be optional. It depends on what you're trying to do, but of course you need a camera. Now, that doesn't mean you need to go off and get a big expensive Sony camera or a Canon or whatever. The camera that you've got on your phone most likely is pretty good quality. Most likely it's good HD quality. So the thing about camera, any will do, but at least HD quality, which on a technical term is at least 720p. Least. Really what you want to focus on, actually, 1080p. So if you're about to go off and buy a camera and the thing says, yes, this shoots 720p video, we'll look to the next one on the shelf that says 1080p video. That one's better quality. It shouldn't really be a big price difference, and your phone probably already shoots 1080p quality. Look at your manual, try it out, but just about any camera will do. If you want to get more professional and get better results, think about a microphone. I can't exactly tell you, get this brand or get that brand. There's such a variety of brands with resultant quality, but like most things, you get what you pay for. So if you're going to spend a little bit more on a camera or a little bit more on a microphone, you'll get better results. All of our laptops, pretty much nowadays, have a little web camera built in. Probably that web camera is barely 720p, which is what I'm saying is the minimum. And probably the microphone's not very good. So you can create videos with your laptop hardware, but probably better to invest in the real hardware. And here, depending on the kinds of videos you'll be creating, you can have, like the handheld microphones, or it's got the fancy term, but lapel microphone. These are the ones you've probably seen, like on news broadcasts and such, that the reporter has a little thing clipped to their shirt. That's a little microphone that's going to record good quality audio. In addition to the visuals of the camera, I'll show examples of possible YouTube videos because, again, I can't say everyone needs these because it depends on what kind of video content you're creating. And I'm not really going to say a particular brand and such, and I can mention what I've used and what I've liked, but it's only my opinion. Plenty of other people have their opinion on a better camera, a better microphone, and such. You need to create the video with this hardware, and then you need the software, which is video editing software. And here there's a variety. of software that we can use. Some of the ones that we have are iMovie for the Mac. We have Windows Movie Maker for Windows. Both of these are free, powerful, easy, easy-ish, easier. One's for Mac, one's for Windows. A level up higher is, for example, Adobe Premiere Elements. This was between $70 to $90. More powerful, less easy. What I mean by that is that it has more features, more things you can do with it, therefore more complication. And then even the highest level, then we're starting to deal with Final Cut Pro. What else is there? After Effects. These are hundreds of dollars. I don't have a price at the moment. Even more powerful, even less easy to use. Basically, this is pro software. We go from amateur software to pro software in that sort of order. And you can create very professional quality results from the amateur software. You won't have every single feature or as many as the powerful abilities as some of these higher levels, but you will be able to create some great things. Personally, as I've said, not only do I teach these concepts, but I'm also part of a company that we do this. In our company, we've used iMovie and Windows Movie Maker to create some very good, some very professional quality videos, which I'll show a couple later. But then going up higher to these levels give you more power. You might not need it. You might be perfectly fine with iMovie and Movie Maker. So you're going to need the hardware, and you're going to need the software. The theory is that you're going to use the hardware to record. We'll talk about like the six or seven types of YouTube videos that might be effective for you. And one of the kinds is where a person talks to the camera. So if I was going to record someone in my business talking about the business, or let's say I'm a realtor and I want to talk about every week or month or whatever, I'm going to have the San Diego Realty Minute, and I'm going to record a video about myself talking about the state of San Diego Realty. I could easily record myself like this, or have the front-facing camera turned on, and I can talk and say, "Hey everyone, we're going to talk about San Diego Realty," etc. That could be fine. That could work. It's going to be better with better hardware and software and such. It might even be better simply putting your camera on a tripod. They sell adapters to put your camera on a tripod because you holding it yourself, your hand's going to move. If someone else is holding it while you're talking, their hands are going to move. A tripod, a classic tripod from any sort of camera or video, the point of that is to keep the camera steady. They make adapters, universal adapters, for every cell phone that it clips onto your cell phone, and then that screws into the tripod. And that's been very useful for us in various aspects. And that way you can set up the tripod right there and then talk to the camera, and it's not going to shake. It's not going to be annoying and blurry and cause people to stop the video. Because I'm going to tell you right here, the secret to a good YouTube video. Don't tell anyone this. The secret to a good YouTube video is good visuals and good audio. Duh, isn't that what a video is? Isn't that the definition of a video? It has visuals and it has audio. But the operative word is good visuals and audio. And yes, our camera may be able to shoot 1080p or even 4K video, which is four times more powerful than regular video. Yeah, maybe your phone camera can shoot that, but your hand is shaky, the lights are too low, you're far away from the subject, and it sounds like camera can't pick it up. So, you have great hardware, but did you record good visuals and good audio? It sounds obvious here, that's what makes a good video, but in practice, it's not. It doesn't happen that often. So, good visuals mean focused on a subject, good lighting, visually interesting. The third and first points are very much related. So if I'm going to do a review of the brand new Aquafina X2K water bottle, well, I'm going to get my camera and question, will I stand here to record it or will I stand here to record it? A or B? Will I stand here, A, or will I stand over here, B? Most likely A. I'm going to stand close to the product to focus on it because if I'm this far away, I'm recording the bottle and my chair and this tape and this thing over here and this over here. There's no focus. You want to focus on a subject. You want to guide people to the main subject. So simply getting close to something or someone is going to help you toward good visuals. Where I'm currently standing, if I'm trying to record here, it still probably won't be that good. I have this set of lights turned off so that you can see the projector better. But then the camera is going to suffer in that it can't record this object as well as it could. If I turned on my other light or if I moved this item to right where the lights are, that would be much better. A dark video that you can't see the subject is not a good video. So I might be close to it to focus on it, but if I can't even see the product, not enough good light, that's another demerit against one of the key requirements. And the visually interesting one is harder to teach. That one is more about, like I'm saying, I've got a desk that's all cluttered here. And I should clean that desk up a little bit. And am I going to record by me standing right here downward? Am I going to record at the same level as the item? Am I going to record upwards? There's all of those things about visual interest to catch people's attention. That one's harder to teach. But these other ones right here regarding focusing and lighting, those are relatively easy concepts to consider in practice. You'll get the idea. Good audio means no noise or buzzing sounds in your recording. Like the drone of a refrigerator or the drone of a fan or, some sort of noise that. I've gotten used to it in the room, but the microphone will pick it up and distort it, and people will notice it when they play it back. So no noise or also distracting sounds. That fire truck siren that blares through half your video, that's going to be a big negative for the audio quality of your video. So we'll say good audio level, simply volume. Because you're hearing yourself talk, you know you're speaking at a good volume. But if you're trying to speak to someone else, you have to perhaps raise your voice. And when you're dealing with the device to record, these are much more designed for them to record audio or use audio like this, with my mouth right next to the microphone. So when I start to record someone that's further than arm's length, it's going to start to lose audio quality. So if I'm going to record the boss of the company talking about the company, the closer I am for the microphone to record their voice, the better. The problem, of course, is if I get too close, then they look weird on the screen because it's the wide angle and they'll look weird. So that's why I'm saying over here then about like a microphone, handheld. They could have, they're sitting at their desk, and you could have handheld or tabletop microphone right there, and you're going to stand at a reasonable distance to record them in the background, but they're going to speak on their microphone. Every time we're in class, I'm recording onto this microphone right here. This is at about arm's length to me, and the audio quality is good. This is a web camera that is actually serving as my microphone. And as I said, there's also those lapel microphones that are less intrusive and they clip onto the shirt and they're connected to the camera or the computer and they're recording the audio. For the two big reasons again, get good visual, get good audio. And then you use the software to create a good movie. And a good movie is defined as mixing these things, good audio and visual and length, depending on audience. And subject. You decide the length of your video. I cannot tell you. Make sure you make a 37 second long video. I can't tell you that. Depending on your audience and its attention span and the subject of your business and all of that. And with experience, you'll figure out what's a good length for my videos. YouTube will help you in that it can tell you second by second people's attention spans on your video. It'll tell you people were really interested in these first 30 seconds, then it started to die down a little bit. And then by the 2 minute mark, it had been down to 25% attention that people have looked at it, and you've got an 8 minute long video. So by 2 minutes in, people are not quite paying attention. YouTube will tell you that with its statistics, its insights screen. Yes.
So you're just talking about that they cut the video off, they just stop watching it after these
Mm-hmm.
points. Okay.
Yeah. YouTube can keep track of all of that. People are watching it and they say, I'm bored, and they move elsewhere, or they hit stop. So using the software, we have to deal with its length, we have to deal with editing. This is creating the best, or focusing on the best subject of your video based on length. If you have some sort of instructional video that you're giving, are you going to set up the camera and have it record nonstop for the full 8 minutes that this process takes? Or are you going to cut out the part where you're just waiting for something to happen? Or are you going to speed up that portion? Like sometimes when we make videos regarding computers, there's some waiting time regarding computers, like installing a website software. We're doing the video and we're saying, download this, click this to install, and then we would have to speed up the process where the computer's just processing it. We don't want to wait 30 seconds. We don't want to have the user stare at the screen while the little timer ticks around. We want to speed that part up. We want editing, maybe even just cut it out completely and say, now that this process has finished, let's do the next step. Editing again, this is the concept of it is just to remove the parts that are not necessary. But to actually do it, that takes practice. Where should I cut my video? How should I cut this video? How does this part flow into that part? In the real world, Hollywood movies and such, the editing part of a movie often takes as long or longer than the original recording. When George Lucas made his Star Wars movies, he spent like 6 months recording it. And then he spent 2.5 years editing it, putting it all together, and recutting it and saying, well, this doesn't make sense anymore, let's change it with this. Oh, this part would be stronger if we do this. And so, 2.5 years later, a Star Wars movie, but it's shot in 6 months. And many times for many movies, that's what happens. People record some amount of time and then spend a lot of time editing it. Edit is from the Latin to eat. So an editor is someone that is eating your words. So editing a video, you're eating away the parts that don't matter or don't help your narrative. And editing is one of these categories in the Academy Awards, best editing. That's when someone figured out this is the best way to present this movie because we cut this part and fixed this part and we made a good movie. Use the software to create a good movie, which would be its length, its editing, its visuals, and also soundtrack. This one could be optional. This is background music. Not every video requires this. And we'll see examples. I've got examples for you. But your video, as you're talking about, like I said, maybe I'm doing for a realty company, the state of San Diego Realty. Every week I'm going to do a video, 1 minute long, about the state of San Diego music, or San Diego Realty, and I've got music in the background while I talk to the camera, good visuals and audio. I talk about the industry and nothing else that visually amazing. There's no graphics showing up. I'm just talking. But behind the scenes, I could have a little music lightly playing in the background. You use your software to set that up. And not every video requires that. Sometimes it would be distracting. There's a lot of conceptual things. We would be able to get into much more detail and practice on a different day of the class. And I've got a video for you that we will use as an example. So when we create this YouTube account in just a moment, you can decide for the full experience to use the video I will provide you, or just learn these things, and when you have a video, apply them. But before we do that, any questions on the concepts we've looked at here? Okay, I've got a video for you then. Let's do this. Let's go to the desktop, and let's open up the computer window. We'll go to the network folder. I've got two documents for you, two items for you. So open up computer. And then you go over to the network location, Classroom Data Drive Z. Double click that one. Classroom Data Drive Z. Scroll down and we'll find our class, which is Campus Social 2. Double click that one. Yes.
Mine was up earlier, and now it says display port no signal. Did I touch something or do something?
Yeah, you might have, when you turned the monitor, you might have jumped over to different connections.
This one's black, but it's dark. You can turn it on. Strange. I even have the file.
That's on.
Just press the little thing next to the yellow.
No. That's how it is. And here it says it is on. These lights show that it is on. But that's not working. You have 20 other computers.
Oh, okay. Here we go. Thank you.
Okay, so inside of the Campus Social 2, what you want to do is drag a copy. You want to drag from my folder to your desktop, drag Campus, get to Campus Tech Review Tuesday, just drag that to your desktop to get a copy of it on your computer, and then also drag a copy of social media YouTube ideas, drag that over to your computer or your flash drive. Get a copy of those two, and then close the network folder, and with those that you've copied for yourself, we're going to work with those. So everyone should take a moment to copy those two over. Call me over if you have trouble finding that. That PDF file is a little bit of theory stuff. We'll look at it in a moment. Let me briefly play this video, a little bit of it, this example video. I think I remember that the audio on this is weird. Hello, everyone. This is Victor Campos for the Tech Review Tuesday.
I'm not
today
sure
I've
why
got
the
some
audio
hardware
is not
for you.
coming out
this
here.
This is the Motorola
Imagine there's
Moto
audio.
E.
But this
it's
is
one of the newest
an example video
running
where
Android.
It's
so
the Tech Review
I highly
Tuesday.
Recommend this device, and let's take a look why.
For this
so
channel,
this device is very good because
channel,
it's very powerful.
It
has all
this
the
technology.
Particular apps
every
that
Tuesday,
we might
I'm
need.
Tech
it,
Review Tuesday.
Lets you do
so
social
here I'm talking
media.
About a particular
lets
product.
You do
notice there's a little bit of text at the beginning. All of this was done with that Windows Movie Maker software.
Hello everyone,
easily
this
also
is Victor Campos
doable
for the Tech
via
Review Tuesday.
iMovie.
Today I've
Next
got
I'm
some
speaking,
new hardware
for
then
you.
It pops up to show. Hello everyone,
Maybe
this is Victor
here.
Campos for the Tech Review Tuesday. Today I've got some new hardware for
product,
you.
And then
this
its
is
name appears on
Motorola
screen. All of that is via
Moto
that editing with
it's
the
one
software.
Of the newest devices.
The angle
like
changes
Android.
A little bit from
so
me holding the
I
item.
I highly recommend this device, and let's take a look why.
Fade right
so
there.
This
so
device
from
is
one
very
angle to another
good because it's
fade.
Very powerful. It has all the media messaging. So as we see here, these are all very useful. And you've got the camera video.
And I
so
give it
five
a review here, and
phone.
I'm saying this
so
is
I give this five out of
five stars.
Stars
a
and
animation
I highly recommend this.
Star
so
rating.
This has been Victor Campos
and
for
the video
Tech
ends.
Tuesday.
And at the end of the video, there's credits. In the credits, it mentions the name of the video, copyright notice, whatever, and then. A little bit of branding. Oh, here also at the end, visit us for exclusive coupons from Amazon. Make a note that this is for a little bit of branding regarding these videos. Everything that we do in a social network is going toward getting you traffic, right? So if we're talking about YouTube, same sort of thing. I want these YouTube videos to get me attention and traffic to my website, sales, etc. So if the person had watched the video to the end, they have here an exclusive offer. They have a link. There's a link here over to my website with an exclusive offer. This requires that I create a landing page. We've talked about landing pages before, which is basically a page you create on your website that the only way you get to it is via some special link. So I can send out an email to my email distribution link that people on that list can only get to this page if they're subscribed. I may tweet about a specific coupon or something on a page of my site, and the only way to get to it is if you follow me on Twitter. Here is, okay, you've got to subscribe to me on YouTube, and on my video I'll have here a special link exclusively for you to go to my website because you're a loyal YouTube subscriber. We would talk about setting that up on the video if we were to make a video, but at least make a note. Think of an idea of adding some sort of incentive to your video. On your video, think about adding incentives to your site. Question?
I've spoken this twice, got some data, and I'm not finding.
You need to find the folder called Campos Social 2.
Social 2. Oh, that one I found. Oh, okay, got that one.
So in your video, when you edit the video, as I showed in my example, well, can I say something on the video to incentivize people to come to my site? Like links, coupons, offers. And so this one's, how long is this one? It's a minute and a half. I can't really tell you about lengths of videos or recommendations. This is going to depend on you, your audience, your product, etc. Because even if you follow all of these tips and more that we'll talk about, one of the things that I have to say regarding YouTube or any social media, you never know what your next hit will be. What your next big hit will be. You never know
if that tweet is going to take off. You never know if that video will. You never know that that video that you spent so long to create will resonate with people. You never know that the one you shot handheld, shaky, is the one that takes off. You never know what will be a viral hit. So, even on regular social media like Facebook and such, if you're contributing or using Facebook once a week, once a month, you know, there's all of that time that you're not using Facebook that you could be using to succeed with it. To some degree, for many of us, it's a numbers game. The more we do it, the more we use Facebook, Pinterest, YouTube, whatever, the more we use it, the more possibility that we could have a viral hit. So YouTube is much harder because you need a video. But let's say with YouTube, I've resolved that once a month I'm going to upload a video. Depending on the kind of video, which I'll show in the handout, you could be releasing a video once a month, you could do it once a week, you do it once a day, depending on the kind of video. Because you never know what will be the big hit. So, try often. Release content or release videos as often as you can. To help go viral. On our own particular company, YouTube, we've released several kinds of videos. One of them really took off. Our videos often have about 80 or 100 views or so. One really took off. It's up at 55,000 views. So they're all related. They're all in the same sort of style and such, but one really was a hit. And that one keeps bringing in more subscribers and money. That one video is generating money every time people view it and such. We'll talk about monetization and the details later. But at the very least, we're using the YouTube videos to promote the company. And a good icing on the cake of that is a little bit of money being earned off of the video simply existing on YouTube. New people finding it, old people re-watching it, new people watching it for the first time, old people watching it again. It's a gift that keeps giving. So the other item in that folder, let's look at this one, that handout. The printer is off at the moment, so you'll be able to print it a little bit later. But what this handout is about, this is YouTube Ideas. YouTube is the granddaddy of all video sharing sites, founded in 2005 and featuring a video from the San Diego Zoo. So the very first YouTube video was someone at the San Diego Zoo. YouTube has gone on to host countless videos and create many viral sensations. YouTube is a great social network to tap into because more and more people are getting their info and entertainment from videos. YouTube has a lot of videos that are purely for entertainment purposes, but there's lots of videos that are how-to videos, explaining something, you can learn something, instructional videos, and so forth. That's why I'm saying it's also useful as a search engine. When I moved into my new place, the previous owners had left me a broken doorbell. So, okay, I need to fix a doorbell. I went to YouTube and I looked up how to fix a doorbell. And I found a video on how to fix a doorbell. Obviously, I didn't electrocute myself. I'm here. And so it worked. I found a useful video on YouTube. Think about that for yourself. Is your company, is your product capable of you creating some sort of video that is how-to or explanatory that people might need or search for? While the following are by no means the only types of YouTube videos that you can create, they should give you a good idea of the breadth of styles and subject matter. Each one of these you can possibly think about and figure out, depending on your company, if it's a viable kind of video for you to create. It's important to create content on a regular basis. You never know which of your videos will become the next viral hit. We'll look at those in a moment. And then we've got a couple of links here, tips for great videos. You can go over to this link here, myvideoseopro.com, and then get some info on creating professional online video. Or even more in-depth, you can go over to vimeo.com/videoschool, and that has a full course for free to teach you about iMovie and Movie Maker and all of those concepts of videos.
There's also a book here, Ultimate Guide to Building a Channel on YouTube. This is an Amazon book you can check out. And this this handout closes then with the new frontier of video, which is the live streaming. YouTube started off as a place to upload completed videos. Those have been edited and ready to go. There's now a whole generation of live streaming sites and apps where you can share video as it happens. And these are the ones I mentioned. Some of them are apps, like Periscope. You load the app on your phone, and then you turn it on, and then people watch you live. You don't have to have, you know, a channel on regular TV. You are a broadcaster. You turn it on and you record. Why that would be useful or how, we might touch on it, but that's a different beast. And then over here, Twitch and Vlad and Facebook itself has its own live version. Ideas for live streaming. Well, a possible reason to use live streaming is behind-the-scenes videos, special events, prize giveaways. Coupling that with announcements on Facebook or Twitter or Google Plus to build an audience. So that would be a different subject to talk about the live stuff. We're focusing on the pre-made videos. And so here I'll show some examples of these videos. You can click on any one of these and it should open it up. And again, for whatever reason, I'm not getting audio off of this. These are a few examples of types of videos. One of them is known as the unboxing video, and yes, literally what it is, it's someone opening up a box. A product box. It's someone that gets a product and opens it up and talks about it and is like a mini review. Many of these kinds of videos that we'll see here sort of kind of bleed into each other conceptually. Let's see if I can load this up after the ad.
Hey there guys, Zach here from InBeta, and welcome back to another video. Now today we're unboxing and taking a first look at the white Microsoft Lumia 650 from, well, Microsoft. This device is it's one of the first Sport 50 box, pretty standard for a Lumia device, especially for a low-end Lumia device. We've got the device on the front of the box, nothing on the bottom. Of course we've got the brand 650 in all of its glory, in all of its wrapped glory, as you can see here. Okay, so if we put that off to one side for just a second, let's take a look at what's actually in the box. It would come with a battery, although I've already put the battery in the device, so that's why it's not in there. So we've got products and safety, boring paper, so we're going to just look at that. And then of course we've got a charging port. Now this is just standard Microsoft charging port that you get in the UK. Nothing fantastic. It's got a little push-up bit there, which is really fun. And then you've got your Microsoft logo, and of course it's a micro USB connector, so nothing special here. No USB Type-C or anything like that, just your run-of-the-mill micro USB charger. Now let's take a look at the device itself. We've got a 5-inch 720p AMOLED screen, as well as metal brushed aluminium kind of button design on the side here. Very nice indeed. Then on the back we've got an 8-megapixel rear shooter, as well as a flash, and a Microsoft logo, which is kind of standard on all Lumias these days. They're not going to come with a Nokia logo. They've been Microsoft logos for quite some time now. On the top we've got a 3.5mm headphone jack, and on the bottom we've got a micro USB connector for the charger and to plug into a PC or something. Now you can also take the back off the device to get access to a nano SIM card slot,
then you see the video and then you share it.
Micro
you
give them SD a shout card out slot Twitter, as well as the you share it on Facebook, 2,000 mAh battery. Taking off and putting the rear shell on the device is actually pretty simple. You just simply have to snap it into place, just like I'm doing here on video. Very simple, kind of like any other Lumia ever, nothing too complicated there. And getting the backup is actually easier. So
copyrights and all of that.
Now, the setup process is pretty much like you would expect any Windows Phone setup process to be, except since this is a Lumia 650, it's running Windows 10 out of the box. So you get additional kind of steps and stuff, but it's pretty much all the same once you get past the initial setup.
And these are popular, as evidenced by this.
Which is very, very nice indeed. So I think we're about to jump to that. I have no idea. Yes, so take a look at the back again. Let's also take a look at the proximity sensor and the proximity sensor and the front-facing camera, because they're quite prominent on the white version of the Lumia 650. But once that's done, you're all set and you're ready to go. So you press done, and I advise you do some updates first, as the Lumia 650 does ship with Windows 10, but it ships with an older build of Windows 10, build 10586.11. There should be a software update available when you open it up, and there should also be 40 or so app updates too. So
that means as soon as WinBeta uploads a brand new video, 40,000 people get a notification
and confirm
that a new video has been uploaded.
You will see that we are running build 10586.11, which is now fairly old compared to the latest available.
Let's pause here. YouTube calls it a channel. Twitter or whatever else would call it a profile. The generic term is account. YouTube would call it a subscriber. Twitter would call it a follower. Facebook would call it a follower. Google Plus, whatever. What a follower is, of course, is a captive audience. On every YouTube video, there's also the ability to like. I like this. Or I dislike this. So there's likes and dislikes, thumbs up, thumbs down. YouTube is one of the networks that has actually dislike. Most other networks have simply like. Facebook has recently added more of these actions. There's, you know, there's the like, the classic thumbs up like on Facebook, and then there's the new ones that's like the angry face and the incredulous face and all of that. So Facebook is starting to change it a little bit, but on every other network it's, you know, a like. And this is an action. It's a positive action, positive or negative action. It's interaction. So YouTube has slightly different terminology, but it's the same concept that we've seen with every other network. If you've been using YouTube for a while, perhaps you might remember that there used to actually be star ratings. You could give a video 5 stars, 3 stars, 4 stars, and they simplified it down to like, dislike. A few years ago, YouTube found that most people were either giving it a very high rating or a very low rating. So YouTube said, let's take away the one in the middle. Let's take away the 2, 3, or 4 stars. Now there's just 1 star, 5 stars, like, dislike. And that seems to have worked for them. Just binary choices. One of the things that's more different, though, is then you've got video views. You don't exactly have that analog for the other pages unless you go into your analytics of all of these accounts. You can see how many people saw my tweet. You can see how many people saw my Facebook post, the reach, and so forth. But where YouTube, it's much more obvious by default how many views a video got, which you can turn that on or off. And there's unboxing videos about everything, not just technology. I could say air conditioner unboxing. So, the needy homesteader has unboxing of the 12,000 BTU LG portable air conditioner and dehumidifier, 9,000 views. Dharmic has a video, the 1.5 ton, 5-star, whatever unboxing, 7,000 views. Sad Clan has unboxing a large air conditioner, 15,000 BTU, 11,000 views. So lots of views. The possibility of why do people care about this is they may be interested in buying that product. They may be interested in, I'm thinking of buying either this 5-star or this LG. So let me look up what other people have said about it. Not only are they opening it up, but most likely they're kind of doing a mini review and an opinion and such, and they're seeing, oh, that requires a 220 volt outlet and I've only got a 120. So it's also somewhat educational. I gave the example about for your company, you could unbox your own product to show what's in the product, or you can have people, you could solicit people to make one for you, and then here's free advertising. So when someone searches your product on YouTube, perhaps, or a regular Google search, that video may show up, which is about your product, and hopefully in a positive way. So all of these examples that we'll look at, you could think about them in terms of how can you make these videos yourself, or how can you ask people to make these videos for you. And that's also a way to use YouTube. Any question on the unboxing video? Screen capture tutorial. This is a specific kind of video. This is the one that will record your computer screen.
Check out these big savings exclusively for Sam's Club business members. Find over $10,000.
Screen.
Hello everyone, this is Victor Campos from PMT Interactive. Let's build an Android app in Visual Studio in 5 minutes. Well, first we need to go online and download Visual Studio 2015.
To download the software, to install it, I'm narrating it, to get my audio to work on this for some reason. And I'm explaining, click here, do this, do that, set this up, and you'll be on your way in 5 minutes to creating apps.
So take a moment to download that.
You never know what's going to take off.
Go through the installer. It's going to be pretty straightforward.
And some thumbs up,
here the most important thing is a custom installation because it has various features that are not on by default.
Before the publication of this video, our channel, we had like 7 subscribers.
You want to make sure
and
you turn on HTML
since
JavaScript.
September.
And
now it's gotten up to 200
subscribers. So just confirm
every time there's a new video,
23 megabyte download in my case.
Get a notification that says there's
so
a new video.
Wait a while.
And some people will then go watch it, some of them won't.
Let it install.
But there's that captive audience.
And then eventually it will let you file.
So the way that you would do this kind of video also requires a little bit of extra software. So the first one, which was unboxing, set up a camera, preferably or hopefully on a tripod, to record the action of opening up a product. Screen capture. The screen capture tutorial. Well, that is going to focus on teaching something to someone, usually. And you will need some sort of screen capture software, something to record your screen. And so one of the ones that I recommend is called Open Broadcaster Software. It's free, it's multi-platform, so Windows or Mac, or Linux. And its purpose is to record your screen. That's what I use every time I'm in the class. If you ever see this thing right here, that's what that is. That's the Open Broadcaster software. It needs some setup. We can't talk about it in the class, really. But it's set up with my microphone. Here it is. There's my voice. It's recording my voice. It's recording my mouse movements. If I wanted to, I could also have it set up so that it records me right there in the corner, right? Because I've got a microphone right here, a little video camera. But this is then software that I would use for free to record what's happening on my screen. I use it to record a lecture. For yourself, depending on your company, if you have some sort of computer company, you know, you want to get hired as a programmer. But what if you give away a couple of short videos here and there, once a month, on these computer topics, where you are writing the code about a topic and publishing it out there and building this resume, this portfolio, to perhaps help you get hired by a company? What if I'm a web designer and I want to get hired to do websites? I could create simple screen capture tutorials about how to install WordPress. I'm not going to give away the whole secrets, of course, maybe condense it down to 5 minutes or something, but I'm building up a name and a portfolio, authority of what I can do. I'm showing people, here's how you can do it.
You can
a lot of times people still can't quite do it themselves, as evidenced by the comments. People are asking, it's not working, help. Well, that's when you start to then offer your services for paid, for payment. So this is a stepping stone. People are interested in this particular video. People want to learn how to make their own app. When they actually get to it, it might be more complicated. So then here's where we're saying, go to our account here, go to the About and contact us. We're available for hire. That screen capture tutorial, again, doesn't apply to everyone. It really focuses on computer topics. Any questions on the screen capture tutorial type of video? The next one is pretty obvious, a how-to video. I like showing off this one, and I wish the audio would work, but this is how to plant tomatoes. And so, how to plant tomatoes, EB Stone, EB Stone Organics. So they're a company that sells organic items like organic seeds and so forth. And so here they're going to tell you about what you need to plant your own tomatoes. And guess what? They sell these items. They're teaching you that you can plant your own tomatoes yourself, super easy. All you need is this, this, and this. And guess what? We sell it. And there's a link on their video itself or on their channel to go get those items. We'll talk about, of course, what should I write here and what should I title it. We'll talk about all of that. Right now, just conceptually, I'm showing you some kinds of videos. This one, I like to show it because it's one of the examples that I think is the most professional and polished. Let me back up. There's a shot of the presenter, you know, from a certain level. She's talking. There's some shots of the dirt. There's a little bit of text. It switches back and forth so that it's not just her being a talking head talking at the camera the whole time. Close up right there. Handheld, it's kind of shaking a little bit. There it is on a tripod, probably. You saw some text in the corner. Again, handheld shot. That could have worked exactly the same or just as well, being a stationary shot like that the whole time. But it's showing here 62,000 views. Here's some intro. Here's some photos. This is a still photo. This is a technique where it's just a photo, and then using the software, it zooms in. iMovie and Movie Maker lets you do that pretty easily. Getting a little fancy right there, and did you notice that it was blurry, and then it got into focus right there? And kind of a faraway shot of actually doing it, then a close shot. This is a very theoretically complex video. A lot of it going on. A lot of editing going on.
Question, do you think EB Stone is paying someone else to do all this for her? Or, I mean, it's not obviously a company.
You never know, but that's the good thing about this. It could be a quote-unquote home video because we've all got the hardware and we can all get the software. So anyone could do this. And there are parts of it that look very professional and there are parts of it that are a little off. So I don't know. I don't know if they did it in-house or they hired someone. But you could do this yourself with enough practice. Just it goes on and it's about 4 minutes long. Like on these shots right here, the color's a little off, it's a little too bright. These other shots look really nice, but then on that certain shot, it's too bright, like right there. They didn't quite record that as well as they could. Maybe you never noticed it unless I pointed it out. Most people wouldn't, but because it's one of the services we offer, I notice these things. And again, oh, that's their product that they're selling, EB Stone Organic Tomato Seeds. Learn how to do this yourself, and don't forget to buy our product. It's a stealth commercial. It's teaching you to do something, but it's focused on their version of the product. And then at the very end, text that breaks it down into these steps. You would use the software to write that up relatively easily. And then at the end, here it is. Here's our soil booster. Here's our organic vegetable plant mix. Here's our tomato and vegetable food. So regarding how-to videos, yes?
Quick technical question. When you're seeing that lady speak to few minutes, and then you go on to a close-up. Do you have to have two cameras, not to have to catch the lip sync that you would if you just stopped and did a close-up with the same one?
It's either or. If you're trying to get the full bust shot and the close-in shot, it might be the easiest to have two cameras so that you have both of those angles. And then in the editor, put them together seamlessly. It could also have been done that they recorded her saying these things from this certain distance, and then they said, okay, let's do version two. They got in closer and had her say the same things or similar things, and then in the editor, still synchronize it all. So it could be all done with one camera, which is more work, or two cameras, but then it's more expensive. You need two cameras. And then it's all up to the software to synchronize it all.
So you don't actually synchronize it manually with two different tracks.
You could. In our experience when we've done this, it's not that difficult really to synchronize it within the software. The big secret with that, which has been around 100 years, is, you know, when you're recording a regular Hollywood movie and they have that clapperboard that they hit at the beginning, that black and white slate thing. The point of that is that whenever they hit that right there, it creates an audio artifact that lets you synchronize the audio better. When you've actually got it in the software, you'll see in the soundtrack there's a spot that is loud where then you can easily synchronize all the videos together. So before recording that, I've got my two cameras set up and say, okay, ready, one, two, three, just clap. That's it. And then you're going to see in your editor these two videos have that point in the audio where there was the clap, and then I can stack them up to properly edit them and synchronize them. So with the how-to videos, create something that helps people. Also, stealth, promote yourself. Or it could be quite obvious. It's up to you. Within the particular tomato video, they were using their own products, mentioning their own products. And at the very end of the video, here's our product. And in the description, here's our product. So we need to talk about titles, eventually descriptions, links, all of that in our videos. It's not just the video. That's why I've got a video rating waiting for you. We will then use it in our channel. The next kind of video that I have here is a review. In the review video, see what this one is. So this one is a quick breakdown of Google Glass. So this is from a few years ago, this item here from Google were the Google Glasses, if anyone remembers those. It was this newest generation of technology where that little, those little glasses there are a computer that you put on and wear, like glasses. It's you talk to it and control it, and here it's giving it a review that it's got these features and such. This one comes from a big, relatively big company. They have 1 million subscribers, CNET. They've been around in the world of technology for 20 years. And so right here, Brian is doing a review of this product and explaining what it's about, the good and the bad about it. And so, again, a review of your product, or have other people doing reviews for you. This is much more complex because, you know, they have the visuals. You saw that there were, I think we saw here, there were also two cameramen. Let's see over here. This is much more professional, that they have two cameramen actually recording him. And then within the editing, all of that is put together. Yes?
What if someone does a negative review?
Unfortunately, any of this negativity online, it's very hard to deal with it in the terms of taking it down. There's so many legal factors about it. The best thing that we can do is to create more content to counteract it or to drown it out. The more of our own content that appears that the search engines find, well, there's only those 10 slots on a Google search result. Yes, there's 10 million results, but people are going to look at the first page, maybe the second. And so the more of our stuff that we fill up with those results, you're crowding out the other ones. And that one that was negative, that was created last month, well, I'm going to create something new every week, every day, every month. I'm going to create more stuff that is just going to be more newer and more relevant than the old stuff. So the opinion about what's negative is very hard to deal with. And it doesn't hurt to try to reach out to them and say, please take that down. It's erroneous. It doesn't go put us in the best light. You could possibly go legal routes and say it's slanderous and libelous, but in the world of the web and such, it's very hard to deal with that. So I really would recommend create more content to surpass that content. This has got 33,000 views. It's a review. You've got reviews about everything. This is one kind of video that you could create or solicit from people to create for you. So a self-review is more of a showcasing your own product. Could be product demo. You're demonstrating your product. Solicit users to create reviews for you, or reviews of your product. Lists, these are videos sort of related to a blog post, in that a blog, in a blog you can write the top 10 this and that, the top 5 whatever, the top 40, the best of this, the worst of that, but in video format. And here it is, the top 5 New York style pizza restaurants in Charleston, South Carolina. And this has got 2,000 reviews. There's 15 subscribers here. Sabatino Cavolo is reviewing these restaurants. The thing, of course, because of all social media being such a public forum, you never know what's going to be a hit, and you never know when something like this will happen. 5 thumbs up, 4 thumbs down. Everyone's got an opinion on pizza. So enough people said, oh, you like Pizzeria Di Giovanni? No, that's terrible. 1 star. or thumbs down, because now we've only got thumbs up, thumbs down. There's no nuance anymore on YouTube. It's either you love it or you hate it. And so here, it's really split down the middle, but one more than halfway. And so that is something that we do open ourselves up to in any of these networks, in YouTube, because it's, by some measurements, the second largest social network. Facebook is the biggest one. YouTube is the second one. There's like 800 million users on YouTube. There's about 1.6 billion users on Facebook. But subscribers and users of YouTube, there's like 800 million. And we will see that we have the tools to sort of prevent this and counteract and deal with this negativity. The defaults err more on the side of openness, in that any crazy person can say any crazy thing, and anyone can give you bad reviews and such. But we have the ability to you know, guide feedback on a positive level once we set up the account. So on lists, showcase 5 or 10 or 100, whatever reasons for your product, whatever reason you you think about. Let's say I have some sort of medical supplement product, and I want to show off here the top 5 reasons why this vitamin is helpful to you. And so we're going to talk about that, we're going to show a video about it, show the product, talk to people, etc., and count down from 5 to 1. Or any sort of complexity I want to do about that. And then the last item is more of the classic commercial. Advertisements. 30-second long ad, 1 minute long, whatever amount of time. Here's an example that we did for a local restaurant. There's some jaunty music playing in the background and behind the scenes shots, and then the food is, takes the center stage. So this is one we did a few years ago, and again, it's all about the visuals, the sound, close-ups. It's a very, like most kitchens, it's very cluttered because it's a kitchen. People are creating the dishes. But notice the close-up and the focus on the items. And this one that we created, we used a Canon camera and iMovie. This was made from iMovie. Oftentimes the big challenge is the sound. So we'll see that with YouTube, YouTube gives us a whole library of thousands of sounds, of songs to use. Because we'll see that, as I said, audio is one of the important things. We'll see that we really have to deal with copyright laws regarding sound on YouTube. But before that, ads. 30-second, well, not, the time doesn't even matter. You can go 15-second, 30-second, 60-second commercials. Commercials about your company. Look at that example in the handout, and then whenever you watch one video, YouTube is going to recommend more videos, usually on topic, but it's going to recommend more videos. And the default is when someone watches a video on YouTube, name of the website, of course, but when a video ends, YouTube is going to do this, autoplay, up next. I'm going to cancel that, but it's automatically going to go to another video that is related. There's Carmelo's Pizzeria. So YouTube is going to have people keep watching and watching videos. If you have more videos to show, YouTube is going to show your videos. There's another one from the same client. So more videos that you create, more possibility that your videos get shown to people.
Yes.
I noticed you don't have anything on short movies.
Mm-hmm.
Short movies that are out there.
Like actual movies with acting and such?
Yeah.
That, as I said on the handout there, these are not the only six kinds. There's plenty more other ones, but that could be a possibility as well, that you have short movies of, 15 minutes, 30 minutes long, whatever, and showcasing your product in or brand in whatever way. That takes more effort because then probably you have actors and all of that, but that's definitely a viable way for advertising as well, creating short movies. Yes?
Transcripts. Is that something, let's say we want to add a caption or just put a transcript in a blog, or that you just create? Is there software that helps you with that, or is it something that has to be done manually?
You know what, YouTube itself can help you with that. YouTube can help transcribe your video. YouTube will take a crack at trying to transcribe what was said, but because it's a machine, it often, and depending on our accents and such, it may not get the best result. But I like to use, and we'll see what it looks like, I like to use the auto-transcribe feature of YouTube, because then I can download that and I can fix its mistakes. So instead of me having to type everything that I've said manually, YouTube can start me off. And then I just go in and fix the mistakes, and I've done that plenty of times, and it's a good way to do it. Ads about your company, commercials, any amount of time. Create more so that they are shown more. The more of your own content that you have on your own channel, the more of your content could be shown to more people, because of autoplay. The default is, as we just saw a moment ago, YouTube wants to show me another video. So if I go look at any video, if I go back to this New York one, it had it set for autoplay, and it was going to go over here to Pizza Tour of New York City. If I did go watch that one, it's going to say, okay, then you might be interested, autoplay the best pizza in New York City. And if I watch that one, it's going to go next to Nella's Authentic, and then after that, New York Pizza from $1 to $1,000. So it's going to be showing me more pizza videos. Sometimes people turn that off. I personally turn it off. But even if it's not autoplay, it will suggest you more videos. So if you create more videos, it'll have more for YouTube to suggest of your own videos. Question?
No, you answered.
Oh. Yes.
If you have, say, 10 videos, will YouTube automatically play those in order, or is there a priority how you get that video or less?
This algorithm here is somewhat of a trade secret, because we're seeing, okay, the next video that's coming up is 250,000 views, which is higher than this one from CNN with 1.5 million views. So it must be more to the algorithm than simply how famous are you and how many videos you have. There's various factors, maybe more comments and other things. Now, there is a way for us to force our own videos to play in a sequence using playlists. So when we talk about playlists, this is how to guide people's viewing habits. We'll say on autoplay, top ideas on autoplay, which is YouTube wants to, by default, keep showing you more videos. Add more of your own to fill the autoplay queue. Don't rely on the algorithm. The algorithm is the computer software that they have that determines what's the next video. Don't rely on the algorithm to show more of your vids, especially in sequence. Instead, organize your vids with playlists to force autoplay in sequence. If I'm Victor's Bakery, and I want to show beginning to end how to make a baked Alaska, and it's a very complex process. I could record the first 2 minutes of it, and then, you know, 3 more minutes of the process, and then 5 more minutes for various reasons. And so then I record all those videos, I upload them as separate videos, and I can then put them all into a playlist. So that the first one plays automatically, autoplay will then want to go to the next one, and then the next one, my own videos in sequence. Or if I'm going to record the Tech Review Tuesday, every week I'm going to record a 1 minute long video about me reviewing technology. I want all my sequence of videos to play, put them in a playlist. When a person starts to watch one of the videos, then it'll go on to the next one, and the next one, and the next one.
I have a question related to that. So is it better, in your opinion, to do like short 1 minute videos, like part one, part two, part three, as opposed to like a 1-2 minute video, now that it's like more content and more videos?
The best answer to that is going to depend on your audience, but we're going to say short videos versus long videos. Depends on your audience. The big pro, the big positivity of why you could do short videos is keep people coming back, right? If you have all of these multiple videos and you're going to release one this week and then the next follow-up next week, people have an incentive to keep coming back. Whereas on the long videos, it's more concise. All the information that a person needs is in the one video, but then you're getting to the point that you've got a 10-minute long video. That might not be so bad. Perhaps, checking our statistics, people like the long videos. There's videos here that are an hour long that get thousands of views. There are videos here that are 2 minutes long that don't get any views. You don't know until you start to see your audience. With both of these based on your audience. Stats. We're going to monitor our stats. We can see it minute by minute. So perhaps for us to figure this out at the beginning, I'm going to juggle those kinds of videos a bit. I'm going to do a long video first, and then I'm going to do short videos, kind of bounce back between them for a little bit, and as I start to get the data, then I can decide this one works better for me. So those are some ideas and possible types of videos, and we can have many more out there. We're going to take our first break, and then we're going to come back and create the YouTube account and see various settings and such that might be valuable to you, and then upload a video and talk about optimizing, because YouTube SEO, search engine optimization, is its own thing. We'll work with that as well and see examples. So 7:28, we'll take a break until 7:38, and we'll proceed.